Today we will start with verse 31. Swadharmam api chaveksya.
Swadharmam api chaveksya.
Navikampitum arhasi.
Navikampitum arhasi.
Dharmyadhi yudhyakshreyonyat.
Dharmyadhi yudhyakshreyonyat.
Kshatriyasya na vidyate.
Kshatriyasya na vidyate.
Considering your specific duty as a Kshatriya, you should know that there is no better engagement for you than fighting on religious principles. So there is no need for hesitation. So Arjuna, as you can imagine, is hesitating. He doesn't want to fight. But Lord Krishna is saying your specific duty as a Kshatriya. As if you are trained as a Kshatriya, you have to do that. And again, it is not by birth, it is by training. Okay, so somebody may want to read this.
Out of the four orders of social administration, the second order for the matter of good administration is called Kshatriya. Kshat means hurt. One who gives protection from harm is called Kshatriya. The Kshatriyas are trained for killing in the forest. A Kshatriya would go into the forest and challenge a tiger face to face and fight with the tiger with his sword. When the tiger was killed, it would be offered the royal order of cremation. This system has been followed even up to the present day by the Kshatriya kings of Jaipur state. The Kshatriyas are especially trained for challenging and killing because religious violence is sometimes a necessary factor. Therefore, Kshatriyas are never meant for accepting directly the order of sannyas or renunciation. Non-violence in politics may be a diplomacy, but it is never a factor or principle. In the religious law books, it is stated, Ahaveshu mitho neoneyam jigham santo mahikshita yuddhamanah param shaktya swargam yanti aparan mukta yagesu pashavo brahman hanyante satatam dvija samskrita kila mantrayascha tepi swargam apavnuvan. In the battlefield, a king of Kshatriya, while fighting another king envious of him, is eligible for achieving the heavenly planets after death. As the Brahmans also attain the heavenly planet by sacrificing animals in the sacrificial fire. Therefore, killing on the battlefield on religious principles and killing animals in the sacrificial fire are not at all considered to be acts of violence, because everyone is benefited by the religious principles involved. The animal sacrificed gets a human life immediately without undergoing the gradual evolutionary process from one form to another, and the Kshatriya killed on the battlefield also attend the heavenly planet, as do the Brahmans who attend them by offering sacrifice. There are two kinds of swadharmas, specific duties. As long as one is not liberated, one has to perform the duties of his particular body in accordance with the religious principles in order to achieve liberation. When one is liberated, one's swadharma, specific duty, becomes spiritual and is not in the material bodily concept. In the bodily conception of life, there are specific duties for the Brahmins and the Kshatriyas respectively, and such duties are unavoidable. Swadharma is ordained by the Lord, and this will be clarified in the fourth chapter. On the bodily plane, swadharma is called varnashrama dharma, or man's stepping stone for spiritual understanding. Human civilization begins from the stage of varnashrama dharma, or specific duties, in terms of the specific modes of nature of the body obtained. Discharging one's specific duty in any field of action in accordance with the orders of higher authorities serves to elevate one to a higher status of life.
Yeah, so this is a very, very key important point. Discharging means performing your duties, one specific duty in any field of action, whether you are an artist, whether you are a potter, whether you are a musician, whether you are, a king or a brahmana or a teacher or a soldier, in any field of action, if you do this, in accordance with order of higher authorities. So it has to be under guidance of higher authorities. It cannot be just you yourself doing something on your own. It has to be always under the guidance of higher authorities. So if you do that, then what happens? You get elevated to the higher status of life. So that is what Swami Prabhupada is trying to do. He's teaching us the process of elevating ourselves to higher status of life. Higher status means initially going to heavenly planets, from there going to the Tapalokas, where you do meditation and worship of the Lord, then Maharloka, then higher to Satyaloka, which is like one step before getting liberated. So all these things are possible if you do your specific duty, but higher authority should guide you. If higher authority is not guiding you, then you are pretty much getting stuck in one stage of life like that. So that process is called Varna Ashrama. So how many Varnas are there? Anybody know?
Four.
Okay, and how many ashramas are there? Okay, so what are the four ashramas? Anybody know?
Brahmacharya, Grihastha.
Then?
Sannyas.
No, Vanaprastha. And then finally?
Vanaprastha and then Sannyas.
Right. So essentially what is happening here is that these four orders of life are there so that you can discharge your specific duty. Right, so everything is an ashrama. Even grihastha is an ashrama. Normally, think grihastha means you are living in a city and enjoying life. But even that, according to scriptures, is an ashrama. We have to perform higher duties. So you have two kinds of duties. What did Srila Prabhupada say? There are two kinds of swadharmas. So if you are not liberated, if I am not liberated, then we have to perform duties of a particular body according to religious principles. So if I am in a particular body, like a human body, then I have to perform certain principles. And then if I am in a family man body, then I have to take care of family. If I'm in a sannyasa body, then I have to take care of, giving knowledge to the general society. If I am a brahmachari body, then what do? I, again, give knowledge and perform certain strict austerities like brahmacharya vrata and things like that. If I'm in a grihastha body, then taking care of family. So that is one kind of dharma. As long as we are not liberated, we follow that. But if we are liberated, then once swadharma becomes spiritual, you see this, becomes spiritual and is not in a material plane, bodily concept. So in the bodily concept, we have certain duties. Brahmanas have to teach, Kshatriyas have to fight. Duties are unavoidable. You cannot avoid those duties. So on the bodily plane, the swadharma is called Varnashrama Dharma, or stepping stone for spiritual understanding. Actually, you don't need to be in Varnashrama Dharma. We can all surrender to Lord and directly get liberated. But none of us is capable of doing that. So that's why Varnashrama Dharma is a stepping stone. So gradually we go through Brahmacharya, then Grihastha, then Vanaprastha, then Sannyasa. Because we are not capable for directly spiritual process. So then within that, we have to discharge our specific duty in any field. So any thoughts and questions? This is a very important concept. Maybe you can discuss amongst yourselves, what is the better way? Is this a good way, this design of Varnashrama Dharma? No thoughts?
Varnashram dharma is needed to build discipline and austerity in life.
Okay, so how does it build discipline and austerity?
So we are not supposed to, we should do what we are supposed to do. And this way it gives the knowledge and discipline.
Okay, that is a good point.
It's kind of moral codes.
No, this is beyond moral codes, right? Moral codes are starting. If we don't follow moral codes, we are considered not even a human being. So, moral codes are just for becoming human being. Yeah.
I have a little different take on this. I don't know if it's a right or a wrong thing. But please let me know. One second. Sorry, Prabhuji. In olden days, people used to think like, okay, until 50 years or 60 years, we are done with our family life. Now let's get into this next stage of learning and spiritually develop ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
But with Kali Yuga, I don't know if people will live up to 60 or even we are raising the, with science, we are even raising our lifespan, right?
Yes.
But is it really needed to wait that long to get to learn? To me, I think this should have been in the school to become a better human.
Yeah. Excellent point. No, we don't need to wait. We don't need to wait at all. That is precisely the point. Only if somebody cannot take to devotional life, then they have to wait. If somebody can take to, might as well do it. You're right. My Hindi teacher died when he was 50 years old. So he went from brahmacharya to grihastha to death. There was no vanaprastha, no sannyasa. He died 50 years. Right? So better not wait. Better take it up. But by the time we come to this knowledge, it's already like 40s, right? So already we are at a disadvantage. We are late. But we should not wait anymore. Because we are late, we should quickly take up to this and wrap it up in one lifetime. So that's an excellent point that you brought up.
So how do you understand Varnashrama Dharma in that relation, Prabhuji?
In Varnashrama Dharma, practically there is no brahmacharya right now. There is no brahmacharya ashrams. So people are growing up at their parents' home only, not like under a guru. Then practically, brahmacharya is not there. There is grihastha. And after that, it is very unclear. Vanaprastha is unclear and sannyasa is also unclear. Right? How many people are going into vanaprastha nowadays? Nobody. Practically nobody. So, basically, we should do the best. I mean, it's a bad situation, but you do the best out of a bad situation. So, you do your best in terms of chanting Hare Krishna, quickly getting to this spiritual knowledge, quickly exiting out of this material world. That's a very good question because it's not possible in the modern time. Nothing is possible in the modern time.
I have one more question on Swadharma. So how, so Swa is self, is that what we should consider as? Like, is it your self-dharma we are talking about or is it the, well, 2 points, like, is it self-dharma as a human or is it self-dharma as a, I'm talking from my term, as a parent and a wife and a citizen, right,
both,
like.
Both. Both. A human being has certain dharmic codes. So dharma from that perspective. And also, human as a parent, as a child, as a society member, as a kshatriya, right? I mean, if you join the military and you say, I don't want to fight, that's not acceptable, right? So from all these angles. So all these angles are category one, which is Swadharma. Then second category is Parodharma. This is when we come to the liberation platform. And then we are not in a material bodily concept. But I hardly have not seen anybody who is not in the bodily concept, right? Almost everybody, just a few acharyas, they are not in the bodily concept, but everybody else is in the bodily concept. So all of the above, right? Whatever you said, this all comes into category one, Swadharma. Swadharma category one. Swadharma category two is you are liberated, but you're still doing spiritual activities in order to get love of God. So that Swadharma category two becomes Parodharma.
Okay.
Is that clear, Mataji?
Yeah. So we have two things, Swadharma and Parodharma. Is that Parodharma?
Parodharma. Yeah, Parodharma, yeah.
And your Parodharma should become your Swadharma at certain stage.
No, when you are liberated, your Parodharma equals to Swadharma. When you are not liberated, you cannot even think of Parodharma because you are still in that material conception, right? Me, my family, my country, my house, my this, my that, right? So therefore, Varnashrama Dharma is a gradual elevatory process to say, okay, I'll go through Brahmacharya, then I'll go through Grihastha, then I'll gradually withdraw from family life. And then if I'm still alive, then I will take sannyas. So that is gradual. But if you're convinced, then you directly jump to Parodharma. Just serve the Supreme Lord. Serving Supreme Lord means like go joining a temple, doing book distribution on the streets to help other people understand this knowledge. Quitting your job. And 24/7 thinking of Krishna. So that is possible. But most people cannot do it. Most means what? 99.9999% cannot do it. So for them, Varnashrama Dharma is there. So there is a gradual elevatory process. Through your Varna, which is Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, and through your Ashrama, Brahmacharya, etc.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Yeah. So this, not many people can do it. Not many people can even hear a Bhagavad Gita class. First day I had 35 students. Now there are 4 students. Right? Not everybody can do it. Krishna says, Raja Vidya, Raja Guhyam. So this knowledge is for kings and sages. Because kings have time to think about this because they have assistants to run the kingdom. And sages, they have given up everything. So this is their only thing. But vast majority of the people cannot think about it. So they are tempted by, somebody will say, believe in Jesus and he'll take care of you. Okay, then they'll become Christians. Because they don't have to do anything, right? They just have to believe, that's it. One line. Most people cannot do it. That's why they don't do it. They give up. They'll say, okay, whatever. I'll just go to office, buy some groceries, cook, eat, and go to sleep. Eat, drink, and be merry. Well, this is tough. This is a tough topic, actually. You need the guts to do it. You need pretty strong guts to be doing this devotional life. Not everybody can do it. And that's why Krishna says, Manushyanam Sahasreshu Kashyad Yatati Siddhaye. Out of million, one person may take up to devotion. These are not my words. Krishna himself is saying. One in a million, as they say, right? One in a million. So there are 8 billion people on the planet, so 80,000 people will take it up. That's about it. Now the question is whether you will be in one of those 80 million. Do you have the courage to be in one of those 80 million? No, sorry, my mathematics. one in a million, 8 billion. Yeah, 8 billion is the population. So 8 million, not even 80 million. 8 million people will take this up, roughly speaking. So better be in that good books of Krishna. Yadrichaya chopapanam.
Yadrichaya chopanamam.
Chopapanam.
Chopapanam.
Swargadwaram apavritam.
Swargadwaram apavritam.
Sukhinaha kshatriyaha parthaam.
Sukhinaha kshatriyaha parthaam.
Labante yuddham idrisam.
Lavante yuttam idrisham.
O Partha, happy are the Kshatriyas to whom such fighting opportunities come unsought, opening for them the doors of the heavenly planets. So if you fight on the battlefield, a dharmic war, heaven is guaranteed. So that's one way to go to heaven. Fighting for dharma on a battlefield, your head will be chopped off, but you'll go to heaven. Not to spiritual world, to heaven. Okay, so somebody can read this. Aryan?
Go ahead, Prabhu.
Oh, sorry, Prabhu.
Yeah,
sorry.
Go ahead,
Arya. Yeah. Okay. As supreme teacher of the world, Lord Krishna condemns the attitude of Arjuna, who said, "I do not find any good in this fighting. It will cause perpetual habitation in hell." Such statements by Arjuna were due to ignorance only. He wanted to become nonviolent in the discharge of a specific duty. For a Kshatriya to be on the battlefield and to become nonviolent is the philosophy of fools. In the Parasara Smriti, or religious codes made by Parasara, the great sage and father of Vyasadeva, it is stated...
Just read the English. Yeah.
Okay. The Kshatriya's duty is to protect the citizens from all kinds of difficulties, and for that reason he has to apply violence in suitable cases for law and order. Therefore, he has to conquer the soldiers of inimical kings, and thus, with religious principles, he should rule over the world. Considering all aspects, Arjuna had no reason to refrain from fighting. If he should conquer his enemies, he would enjoy the kingdom, and if he should die in the battle, he'd be elevated to the heavenly planets, whose doors were wide open to him. Fighting would be for his benefit in either case.
So this is, he's a Kshatriya or a warrior. For him to not fight is the philosophy of the fools. Right? Prabhupada uses the term philosophy of the fools. So fools also have their own philosophy. They will take whatever is easiest from other philosophies and then make their own philosophy. And the entire, at present time, most of the world is foolish because they cannot do 100%. So they'll take 2 or 3% and they'll just do it. Right? Like, for example, Jesus never said, if you just say, I believe in you, you'll go back to Godhead. He said, you have to follow so many things. But people cannot follow anything. So they now change Christianity into what? Believe in Jesus and you'll be liberated. Just believe, huh? Just say one line. Once I was there on the street distributing Bhagavad Gitas to the people, which is a good thing to do because other people may learn this knowledge. So one person come and said, tell me, you believe in Jesus? I said, yes, I believe in Jesus. He said, now you're a Christian and you're liberated. What? One line and you're done? So that's the philosophy of the fools. So they cannot do the tough things. So they dumb it down. Dumb it down to one line bumper sticker. In America, if it doesn't fit on a bumper sticker, it's not philosophy. So it has to fit on the right corner of a bumper of your car. And the people behind who are driving, they will see that little slogan. So, Krishna is challenging the attitude of Arjuna. Arjuna is saying, I do not find any good in this fighting. Doesn't mean anything, actually. This will cause perpetual habituation in hell. So it is like a small kid teaching his father, right? No, you should play with fire. Playing with fire is a lot of fun. And father is saying, Arey, you foolish kid, if you play with fire, your hand will be burnt. Similarly here, Arjuna is telling Krishna, it will cause perpetual habitation in hell. Oh, if I kill all these people, I'll go to hell. And Krishna is saying, if you don't fight, you'll go to hell because you are a Kshatriya. So Arjuna came to the exact 180 degree opposite conclusion, just like the modern times. Most people come to exact opposite conclusion about any topic, about politics, about marriage. People come to. Yesterday I was, looking at some billboards. The billboard says, don't divorce, call this number. Divorce has gone to such a high extent. Now people are begging other people, don't divorce, call this number, we'll help you, counseling. So that's how it is. Ata chetvam imam dharmyam.
Atha chetatvam imam dharmyam.
Sangramam na karishyasi.
Sangramam na karishyasi.
Tatasva dharmam kirtim cha.
Tatasva dharmam kirtim cha.
Hitva papam avapyasi.
Hitva papam avapyasi. Avapyasi.
So one thing I noticed is the three Matajis who are on the call right now, you all have very good pronunciation. So you should all teach Bhagavad Gita to others, starting with your kids and then with your neighbors and extended neighbors like that. Because we have a shortage of teachers. Who is teaching Bhagavad Gita right now? Practically nobody, right? So you should take it up. Just teach your kids, teach your neighbors, teach your in-laws. And when your kids get married, teach your daughter-in-laws like that. And then the entire world later. If, however, you do not perform your religious duty of fighting, then you will certainly incur sins for neglecting your duties and thus lose your reputation as a fighter. So Krishna is now giving practical reality check. He's saying, if you do not perform your religious duty of fighting, fighting is religion here. Some people think fighting is like bad. Well, who said fighting is bad? If people misbehave, it's a king's duty to discipline them. So fighting is necessary. Then you will certainly incur sins for neglecting your duties and thus you lose your reputation as a fighter. Okay, I need a volunteer to read.
Arjuna was a famous fighter and he attained fame by fighting many great demigods, including even Lord Shiva. After fighting and defeating Lord Shiva in the dress of a hunter, Arjuna pleased the Lord and received as a reward a weapon called Pasupatakastra. Everyone knew that he was a great warrior. Even Dronacharya gave him benedictions and awarded him the special weapon by which he could kill even his teacher. So he was credited with so many military certificates from many authorities, including his adoptive father, Indra, the heavenly... Prabhuji, scroll down. The heavenly king. But if he abandoned the battle, not only would he neglect his specific duty as a Kshatriya, but he would lose all his fame and good name and thus prepare his royal road to hell. In other words, he would go to hell not by fighting, but by withdrawing from battle.
Okay, very good. So, he would go to hell not by fighting, but by withdrawing. So he thought, Arey, if I kill all these people, I'll go to hell. The Papa. Because killing human beings is sinful. Killing animals is sinful. Killing birds is sinful. But here, Krishna is saying, by withdrawing, you'll go to hell. because you are a Kshatriya. So this is the Kshatriya Dharma is saying. And similarly, there is Brahmana Dharma, there is Vaishya Dharma, there is Shudra Dharma. But now in the modern times, very difficult to say who is who. Everybody is becoming a Shudra. Akirtim chapi bhutani.
Akirtim chapi bhutani.
Katha ishyanti te vyayam.
Katha ishyanti te vyayam.
Sambhava sambhavitasya chakirtir.
Sambhavitasya chakirtir.
Maranadati richyate.
Maranadati richyate.
People will always speak of your infamy. And for a respectful person, dishonor is worse than death. Right? So, if you have been respected once, then dishonor is worse than death. And Arjuna has been respected very much because he was Mahabaho, Savyasachi. But now, his reputation will go down the tube, as they say. Okay, so who didn't read so far? Srujana, you didn't read, right?
Prabhuji, I just read.
Okay, Vidya, please read.
Both as friend and philosopher to Arjuna, Lord Krishna now gives his final judgment regarding Arjuna's refusal to fight. The Lord says, Arjuna, if you leave the battlefield before the battle even begins, people will call you a coward. And if you think that people may call you bad names, but that you will save your life by fleeing the battlefield, then my advice is that you would do better to die in the battlefield. For a respectable man like you, ill fame is worse than death. So you should not flee for fear of your life. Better to die in the battle. That will save you from the ill fame of misusing my friendship and from losing your prestige in society.
Yeah.
So the final judgment of the Lord was for Arjuna to die in the battle and not withdraw.
Very good. So this is a very key word, right? That will save you from the ill fame of misusing my friendship. So Lord is worried about his own reputation also. He's saying, they'll say, oh, Arjuna is Krishna's friend, right? Because they used to sleep on the same bed, big king-size bed, or even double king-size bed, because these are all kings, right? And they used to have this huge marble-laid, ivory-laid beds. They used to eat from the same plate, believe it or not. If you go to Jaipur, and if you go to Rajasthan in general, in marriages, they'll have this big plate, and three people will be eating from the same plate from three corners, like that. So they used to eat from this big plate together. They were very pakka friends. And he's saying, you will ruin my reputation also, misusing my friendship. And then losing your prestige in society, that people will laugh at you. So this is very important. Krishna is saying, not only your reputation, but my reputation will also go down if you don't find the battle as a Kshatriya. Bayadranad uparatam.
Bayadranad uparatam.
Mamshe yante tvam maharataha.
Mamshe yante tvam maharataha. Rathaha.
Yesham chatvam bahu mato.
Yesham chatvam bahu mato.
Bhutva yashyasi laghavam.
Bhutva yashyasi laghavam.
The great generals who have highly esteemed your name and fame will think that you have left the battlefield out of fear only, and thus they will consider you insignificant. Lord Krishna continued to give his verdict to Arjuna. Do not think that the great generals like Duryodhan, Karna, and other contemporaries will think that you have left the battlefield out of compassion for your brothers and grandfathers. So this is a very good point, right? If somebody runs away, they'll not say, oh, he ran away because he likes me. They'll say, ha ha ha, he ran away. Thus, their high estimation of your personality will go to hell. So Arjuna had a high personality. At least in society, he was treated high. Bahumato means everybody used to think. Mat means path. Mat also means opinion. Bahumato, everybody's opinion. What will happen to that Bahumato? Laghavam means decreased in value. Arjuna is also like me, or even less than me, he ran away. Every soldier will think like that.
Prabhuji, can we understand so far that it's Sri Krishna is like, I'm not getting the right word. It's like, it kind of a threatening, not threatening, or blackmailing kind of with Arjuna.
Yeah. He was like, actually blaspheming Arjuna. Yeah. Helena is the right word. Means Helena, he's making a mockery. He's making a mockery of Arjuna. Hey Arjuna, I used to think you are a good friend. What are you saying? Hey Arjuna, I used to think you are a great descendant of Bharata. What are you doing? Hey Arjuna, you are son of Kunti, but now you are letting your reputation go down the drain. So he is mocking him continuously. Because in Kshatriyas, that's how they do, right? Before fighting, they will mock each other so that they can get the adrenaline, the blood pressure high, and then they'll start fighting, tuck, 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 like that. So both are Kshatriyas. Although the Lord is neither a Brahmana nor a Kshatriya, he comes as a Kshatriya here, and he comes as a Brahmana when he comes as Vaman Dev, right? So he comes as different, Varnas in different times. So he's just mocking Arjuna to get his BP high, blood pressure high, and his adrenaline high, so that he'll be ready for fighting. Because, if you really think about it, all this happened in 1.5 hours time frame on the battlefield. He's just coaching him right now. So he starts as a friend, then becomes a coach, then becomes a guru, then finally reveals that he's the Supreme Personality. Right? So gradual evolution of revelation. He's revealing gradually. Right?
Right. Thanks, Prabhuji. Yeah, that's what I wanted to understand. Yeah.
Like if you see Bible and Quran, they are secondary revelations. God gave some knowledge to one guru and then the guru speaks. But here, God himself is revealing gradually. Your enemies will describe you in many unkind words and scorn your ability. What could be more painful to you? So he's appealing to his ego, right? Okay, somebody read this. Aryan.
Lord Krishna was astonished in the beginning at Arjuna's uncalled for plea for compassion, and he described his compassion as befitting the non-Aryans. Now in so many words, he has proved his statements against Arjuna's so-called compassion.
Excellent. Right? So he's mocking at Arjuna's so-called compassion. Right, Sujana? That answers your question.
Yes, Prabhuji. Totally, yeah.
हतो वा प्राप्यसि स्वर्गम्
हतो वा प्राप्यसि स्वर्गम्
जित्वा वा भोक्षसे महिम्
जित्वा वा भोक्षसे महिम्
तस्मादुत्तिष्ठ कौन्तेय
तस्मादुत्तिष्ठ कौन्तेय
युद्धाय कृतनिश्चयम्
Yuddhaya krita nishaya.
Okay. So there is a question in the chat window. How do you stay Krishna conscious when you're also working to further someone else's business, corporate? Okay. Answer is, somebody else is doing some karma activity and you are supporting them in their karma. So you use part of your income to build a temple, to build a farm, to protect a cow. So let that person get rich. It's okay. But you use whatever riches you get, part of it to serve Krishna. Okay. Second question. How do you go towards doing akarma? No ego for doing a good job or worried about results of karma. No anxiety about performing it well. This is a big challenge because we are working in mode of passion society, right? Corporate world means mode of passion. Achieve more, do more, be more. All these slogans that you hear in advertising. Be more, do good, be well, raise your potential, right? What do you want to be today? Microsoft's slogan 10 years ago, 12 years ago. Where do you want to go today? Everything about achieving something. So that's not a karma, that is karma. But again, the answer for this is also the same as answer for one. Earn money, use that, at least a portion of that to saving cows, donating for farm communities, donating for temples, or if you have enough money, build your own temple for the Lord. Right now, the society is so topsy-turvy. Our bank says, oh, with your money, you can get a 5-bedroom home. And after paying the mortgage, you only have $2,000 left. And after paying for groceries and kids' education, you have $200 left. So how can you build a temple with $200? You cannot do anything. So we have to move towards simplistic lifestyle. That is why I bought a farm in Texas with an experiment to move to the farm and do simplistic living, from complex living to simple living. So, you know, a lot of experiments are going on across India in ISKCON, many farm communities in Nandagram in Gujarat. There is one in coastal Andhra Pradesh in Srikakulam. There is one in Karumandura in Karnataka, Salem in Tamil Nadu. So many farm communities are coming up to do this experiment. Can I do this? Can I not work for corporate America and work in mode of goodness for the Lord? Because if you work for corporate America, you are in mode of passion. End of story. And passion means, what did I say earlier? If we die in mode of passion, we'll take birth again. Punarapi maranam, punarapi jananam. Passion equals to rebirth. So we have to get out of this mode of passion. At least 2 hours before death. Quickly come into goodness, transcend the goodness, think of the Lord and leave the body. But if you work till the last day of your life, like one GM died in Microsoft on the desk. He died at his desk. So he died in mode of passion. So he'll take birth first as an animal for his bad karma. And then he'll take birth as a human for his good karma. But he'll take birth guaranteed. No question of liberation there. So does that answer your question?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yeah. So it is a challenge. It is a challenge, actually. Especially, right, from childhood, we were encouraged by our parents. Yes, go get engineering degree, achieve something, go to America. Yes, we did all this. But as a result, now we are in mode of passion. Like when I go to India and I see, most people don't care about becoming very highly wealthy or anything like that. They'll just somehow or the other, yeah, I have a job, government job, something. I'm just, I have a decent income. I'll just, worship the Lord. So like in the Sunday morning, temples are full. Of course, it's not guaranteed that they'll go back to Godhead because they're still, not coming to that transcendental level, right? So from goodness, they are stuck in goodness. You have to go to transcendence, means now you should understand the position of the Lord through jnana, like what we are doing, reading Bhagavad Gita, and then giving up that last 20% of whatever passion that they have. Everybody has passion in this world. So we have to get rid of that remaining passion, come to pure goodness and get liberated. And beyond liberation is getting love of God, right? So loving God. Right now, we don't love God. So it's a two-stage process. I was actually, let me see if I have that slide still. I was making this slide for my students yesterday. Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is much, much more advanced textbook. So there they talk about the continuum of religions. So Gautam Buddha, Nirvana, non-existence after death. So this is very easy, right? I won't exist. So I do good or bad, how does it matter? Then Muhammad, followers, they do worship formless God. Allah is formless according to them. Then Advaitavada, Nirakara, again formless God. Then Jnanis, theoretical study of scriptures. They worship the Brahman effulgence or the light of the Lord. So around the Lord, there is light and that is power, better than just matter, right? So people, Jnanis, get attracted to that. Then Sankhya philosophy, analytical study, like Kanada, Kapila and Dattatreya. Dattatreya worshipped in Maharashtra. Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. He has three heads of Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh. Even though he is the incarnation of the Lord, still he doesn't give full philosophy. He hides something. Kapila, he gives analytical study of the world, like five senses, five indriyas, external and internal indriyas, five dhatus, right? You know, the bhumi, apo, nalo, vayu, earth, water, fire. So that is analytically studying the world, but still they don't give you full information about the Lord. Then you have this Jainism, worship of Mahavir, Tirthankars, and Jains also worship Lakshmi Mata. They all like businessmen, right? So along with Mahavir, they will worship Lakshmi and saying, oh, Lakshmi, give me more money. And she gives, right? Because their focus is mostly on money, not on liberation. Most of the great businessmen in India are all Jains. Then you have the yoga systems, Patanjali, Gautama. So they worship the Antaryami, the super soul, the Paramatma in the heart. They stop there. Then you have Jesus's followers, they worship the personal God, but they don't know who God is. That's the biggest problem for them, right? They don't know what God's name is. They say God, but you know, some people say Yahuwah, Yahweh, like that. Yahweh was worshipped by the Jews who came before the Christians. But Bhakti Yoga is the only thing which shows worship of God as a person, Krishna. You may say, oh, because you are Indians, you are worshipping Krishna. No, whether you are Indian, American, doesn't matter. Bhakti Yoga is for Krishna. The other ones, they are Muhammad's followers are worshipping only formless God, right? Shankaracharya's followers are only worshipping formless God. But God as a form, worship him in that. And then finally get to love of God, right? Everybody says, you know, Valentine's Day, so buy some roses, give it to your, you know, honey, like that. People have these different views. So I send this to my family, right? Krishna krishneti krishneti yo mam smarati niyatsaha jalam bitva yata padmam naraka dudarami aham. In the Narasimha Purana, the Supreme Personality of Godhead declares, as the growing lotus flower breaks through the water, I pull from the hell a person who's chanting Krishna, 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 always remembers me. Just by chanting Krishna, 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 you can come to Krishna, right? So there are various lectures around that. So Valentine's Day is not for buying roses, wine, and consequently after these two things, it leads to sex. But that's not the goal of Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day is to love God. Who started Valentine's Day? Saint Valentine. He's a saint. He said, love God. He didn't say, you know, buy roses, buy greeting cards and drink wine. That was not the goal at all. So people got it all mixed up. Yeah, somebody had a question here. How Chaitanya Charitamrita is important opens the door to Vrindavan. You should read it. I didn't understand because higher level of knowledge. Yeah, this one was from Chaitanya Charitamrita. I do a Chaitanya Charitamrita class every Saturday at 7 p.m. So you're welcome to join that class as well and learn. So Chaitanya Charitamrita talks about more of these detailed stuff. Ultimate goal is just love of God, right? But you cannot just hear an inspiring lecture about Chaitanya Charitamrita. You have to do systematic study. So I encourage you to come to my class on Saturday, 7 p.m. Pacific.
How far you have taught?
I am in Adilila. I just finished chapter 1 and I am in chapter 2, verse 3.
Okay.
So you didn't miss anything if you want to come. That is very beautiful. Chaitanya Charitamrita, little difficult to understand, but if you do that, you will come to a higher level understanding. Bhagavad Gita is elementary. Srimad Bhagavatam is master's level. Chaitanya Charitamrita is PhD level. And then you have Sandarbhas, postdoc, like Paramatma Sandarbha, Tattva Sandarbha. Because in Chaitanya Charitamrita, these Sandarbhas are quoted, very advanced topics. And then if you go to Sandarbhas, even more advanced textbooks are quoted. Ultimate goal is only one, develop love of God. Because right now we don't love God, we love everything else except God. Right? Look at this chain, right? Different people have created their own religions, all escaping God. And therefore they won't go to God. Simple. There's one more question in the chat window. How do you balance family, work, and getting knowledge of our scriptures? Just like I'm doing. I'm giving this class. So you teach Bhagavad Gita. Your students will keep you honest. Right? Your students will keep you honest. They will ask you questions. And then you have to go back to the literature and research to answer their question. So some of my students have already started teaching. They became teachers. So how do you balance family, work, and getting knowledge? Yes. Sleepless. Sleepless, so you have more time for all these things. And involve your kids also. Like we have a family chat, WhatsApp chat. So we discuss everything in that one. We discuss about Trump. We discuss about economy. We discuss about devotion. We discuss about Bhagavad Gita, right? So what did I do? This is my extended family WhatsApp chat. I'll show you that. So in this extended family WhatsApp chat, somebody said, Happy Valentine's Day. Immediately I said, Understanding Valentine's Day from one of the Swami, ISKCON Swami. I sent them a link. Then I said, Krishna, Krishna, Krishneti. Otherwise, just putting three lines, Happy Valentine's Day. What does it mean? It doesn't mean anything. Waste of typing. Right? So our whole life should be Krishnaized. Morning till evening, you should be wrapped around Krishna. Work for Krishna, cook for Krishna, talk for Krishna, sleep for Krishna. Why do you sleep? You sleep so that your body is rejuvenated, so that tomorrow again you can talk about Krishna. I give three classes, Friday evening, Saturday evening, Sunday afternoon. This is the Sunday afternoon class, right? So I used to do a Thursday class also, but then due to a combination of reasons, I stopped that, right? As I come close to retirement, I will do classes 7 days a week. Then I cannot but think of Krishna. So you have to balance. What can you do? Like I used to drop my son at Taekwondo class, sit in the car and chant Hare Krishna. I used to drop my daughter at Bharatanatyam class while waiting in the parking lot. I used to chant Hare Krishna. Everybody has 24 hours only. It's not like somebody has 25 hours. So you have to somehow squeeze in. Office during lunchtime, when everybody else is talking nonsense, I used to say, oh, I need to go on a walk. So I used to walk around my office building and chant. So yeah, it is possible. It takes time and effort, but it is possible. How should I continue in Krishna conscious while being in high school and moving to college life? College life is a big black hole. So much nonsense goes on in college. People have these different viewpoints. Somebody wants to become a communist. Somebody wants to become a socialist. Somebody is propounding capitalism. Somebody is doing their startup company. Very difficult. So you have to put in constant effort. You should not stop these classes. You should come to these classes from wherever you are on the planet. Right? For example, right now I'm outside of Seattle, but I'm still doing the class. So you can do it. Wherever there is Wi-Fi, you can listen to lectures. You can chant anywhere. You can chant in your laboratory. You can chant while walking to college. And people will respect you for that, actually. Because they see 80, 90% of the people are doing nonsense. You are one person who is doing something sensible, right? You have a higher goal in life. Most people don't have a goal in life. Most students don't have a goal in life. When they see you, Aryan, that you have a goal in life, they will actually fall at your feet. Right? They'll say, wow, here is one person that is doing something meaningful with his life. They'll say hallelujah to you. So it is possible. It is difficult, but possible. And in nowadays, in every college campus, there is at least one professor who is Hare Krishna. Like one of the devotees in Seattle went to University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, top college. So by the second day, he found that one of the professors is also a Hare Krishna devotee. And he does programs at his home. So now this student goes there and joins his classes there. Everywhere you are, you know, I was traveling in the first class flight from Seattle to Kyiv, Ukraine, no, New York to Ukraine. And then I was just flipping through the various channels. Then I saw Krishna Das, Hare Krishna Mantra. So I put my headphones on and I was hearing his kirtans. So who would have thought that in, you know, in a first class seat in an international airline between New York and Ukraine, you can hear Hare Krishna. It is there. Just like Jesus says, right? Seek and you shall find. If you seek, knowledge is there in the world, everywhere. Yesterday, I met my wife's former colleague from 22 years ago. And then he said, yeah, I go to the ISKCON Secunderabad and I'm hearing their lectures. Right? So there is always there. Somebody somewhere is having this knowledge. You just have to align with those guys. And because of the internet, you can go to ISKCON Vrindavan, ISKCON Mayapur, ISKCON Seattle, ISKCON Detroit, Atlanta. You have like a whole palette of choices where you want to hear the lectures from. Throughout the world, huh? That is the power of Prabhupada. He established this anywhere and everywhere in the world. So it is possible. Okay, let's chant now. Enough of theory, some practice.